Papa, and anybody else who might be anywhere in the world listening and watching, which from my point of view is quite scary, okay? But you're all very welcome. I'm hosting and doing the first session of this with you this afternoon. I will be followed by Jason Holland, who is just sitting here at the front where he's waving, who some of you may know as head teacher at Montpelier Primary School here in Plymouth. So you'll have two different perspectives this afternoon. Mine, a lecturer in higher education, previous primary school head teacher, and a teacher in a primary school and also in a secondary school, and you'll have the viewpoint of a head teacher still very much in the, I'm seeking the right adjective here, Jason. In the thick of it, okay, and still very, very much in that. Okay, now, who should define the curriculum? Now, with my session, what is very important to remember is that, yes, it's me, and I'm standing here, and you know me, or most of you know me, as a lecturer here, but what I'm going to talk to you about this afternoon is very much through my eyes. It's the Kathmere lens, okay, of who should define the curriculum. Because as you are exploring this week and for the next 3 weeks, how you are going to begin to address that question, then obviously it's your own viewpoint that you will be starting with. So I'm making no apologies for the fact that you may find this controversial, you may not agree with it, I hope you don't, and I hope you offer different viewpoints and ask questions. You may find it political, I'm looking at it from my eyes and my viewpoint, and politics do enter into it. Okay, so please think questions, think what you want to ask, do disagree. Okay, so what's my lens then? What's my starting point? What makes me tick as a teacher? Why do I teach? What is it all about? And it's that absolute belief that every single child, no matter where they are, not just in this country, but all over the world, wherever they live, whatever their background, whatever the socio-economic situation that they find themselves in, whatever race they are, whatever gender they are, whatever, it's that fundamental right to the very best quality of learning and teaching that we can offer and provide those opportunities. And that's my vision, those are my values, that underpins everything else that I'm going to talk to you about this afternoon. So as we start unpicking this then, what does that mean? What does the very best quality learning and teaching, particularly learning, what do we actually mean by that? Okay, what is that learning? What do we want children to learn? Because as I've said to my group several times this week already, then if I was writing this assignment, then for me, in order to decide who should define the curriculum, what that curriculum consists of, first of all, what we need to consider is, well, what's education for? What's its purpose? Because if you can construct that, thinking that's what the purpose of education is, therefore, this is what children need to learn. Okay. So, it's exhaustive of what the purposes of education could be. This is by Nick Gibb, who's the schools minister in the current Conservative government. And as you can see, it's a speech to the Education Reform Summit last year, 2015. And thinking that this is the Catholic lens, okay, I read through his entire speech. And of course what I did is I picked out parts of it that I felt were pertinent to the argument that I was putting forward. If you're interested in what the group has to say from a government perspective, then read the whole thing, because there is more to it than this. He does define other purposes other than education is also about the practical business of ensuring that young people receive the preparation they need to secure a good job and a fulfilling career. So that, as an example of that whole argument of what we're about in school, whether it's primary or secondary or in university, it's about preparing children and young people for the world of work, to enable them to get a good job. One of the perceived purposes of education. I think it's interesting that he uses the metaphor, education is the engine of our economy, but it's also the foundation of our culture, and it's an essential preparation for adult life. And if you subscribe to that view, then what will that curriculum therefore look like, if that's what you believe to be its purpose? Okay. That more people have the knowledge and skills they need to succeed in a demanding economy. What economic purpose of education? A couple of people in my group this morning were talking about PISA, the Programme for International Student Assessment. It's a series of tests in maths and English for 15-year-olds in participating countries, and the results are used to rank order countries in terms of how their 15-year-olds perform in these tests. And you will already know something about these. You will be aware, and I would imagine that Miles yesterday, in talking about Finland, did he refer to PISA? Yeah? Okay, so over the years that these tests have been in operation, it has rank-ordered countries. And Finland, for the past few years, has come out very, very well indeed. So, I'm going to throw, this is a question. So what's happened as a result? You tell me. Finland, Shanghai, countries featuring at the top of these league tables. What effect has that had on education changes in this country? It's a huge question. Johnny?
I want to say about the mastery in maths.
Go on.
Very smart of it.
Okay. Do you want to expand a little bit for us?
The idea of having this depth of knowledge rather than progressing pupils faster if they're able to do that, like giving them a wider and deeper understanding in mathematics.
Okay. So looking at different ways of achieving that mastery. Okay. What's the government done for the last few years? Thank you, Johnny. What's the government, our government, done in the last few years in terms of these countries at the top of the PISA league tables? Sent delegations to countries, what are they doing well, how are they doing it, what can we take to put into our system to improve our education? Yeah, thank you, Catherine. So, but, I've got a sneaky, well, I think Jason refers to PISA a little bit later in his as well. But you think, okay, well, yes, isn't that feasible? But there are all sorts of issues with PISA in terms of how transferable are different systems from different countries and different cultures to our particular education system. Government's been accused of cherry picking and saying, well, that sounds interesting, we'll take that bit and we'll do this bit. Okay? In order to compete globally with our economy, to make our economy the strongest. So education perceived as the vehicle, the engine, as Nick Gibb says, to actually make sure that we do compete and compete favourably in the world. Is that what education is about? That's a rhetorical question at the moment. Okay. Another school of thought.
So people on the live stream are wondering whether you could move into the camera.
Because Kath has I apologise. because I'm just going out of the light, it's better. I do have an awful, and it's probably a big primary school teacher. I move around.
Wonderful.
Some lectures find me at the back of the room, so I apologise. I'll stand still. What another school of thought is that education is a way of sharing with children and young people what the nation perceives to be important knowledge. So this is another quote from Nick Gibb earlier this year. Okay. An understanding of the world around them. People should know the rules of maths, natural sciences, great historical events. In short, they should be given the gift of knowledge. And I think we can safely argue that for the coalition government and certainly the current Conservative government, that perceived body of knowledge that should be passed on to different generations of children and young people, that's what education is about. And you can argue that that's why the national curriculum is knowledge-based as opposed to being skills-based. Okay. This is important knowledge that children need to know. And let's just stop and question that for a moment. Is that what education is about? But who decides? Who decides what this body of knowledge is? When I last worked on this module, Michael Gove was Secretary of State for Education, and there was a view that the national curriculum, the revised national curriculum that he was instrumental in driving forward, this knowledge-based curriculum was actually a reflection of his own education back in the 1950s and 1960s. Some people would describe it as this very narrow, knowledge-based, desired learning that children should know. Well, what should they know? And who should decide that? Should that be politicians? Should that be civil servants working in the Department for Education? You know, and thinking about their experiences and their lives and their culture and their heritage, why is it that narrow group of people that, in apparent consultation, are actually saying this is what the curriculum should look like? Okay. I must put a Michael Gove quote in there. Okay. It's the means by which everything that is best in our society is passed on to succeeding generations. Everything that is best in. That's a huge value judgment, isn't it? If I was deciding the curriculum, which actually is not a bad idea, would, because of my experience, then would that curriculum be very different? My things that are, you know, the best in society to pass on, is that going to be different to Jason's? Is that going to be different to Johnny's? Okay, depending on our viewpoints. So it's hugely complicated, but it's just an interesting who decides what's the best to pass on. A school of thought that, question at the bottom, is our curriculum fit for purpose? That very recently reviewed and written and published national curriculum, is that actually fit for purpose in the 21st century? When we think about, you know, Ken Robinson's video that you will have watched this week, that whole idea that we are educating children for a future that we don't know what it looks like, they don't want to know what it looks like, we don't know what jobs they will be doing in the future. Because of technological change and development and that ever increasing and rapidly increasing change in our world. You think about how much has changed in 10 years since you were really nine. That's ridiculous, isn't it? When you think about that pace of change that is ever increasing, then old Ken Wood, in his book Creative Schools, says the old systems of education weren't designed with this world in mind. Okay, improving them by raising standards, so the debate around what we teach is all about raising standards in school, isn't going to meet the challenges that we now face in terms of the future. And one of the things that several groups of, if not all of you, would have been asked to think about this week is, well, if the curriculum needs to change, what would you put in it? What needs to be in it now in terms of the future? Considering theorists and philosophers and ideologists, the idea that, contrasting very much with education, is about the global economy and the engine of our society, the whole idea to explore that learning is actually for learning's sake, and that learning and that gaining a greater understanding and awareness of a whole range of things, of concepts and ideas and ideologies, is actually the purpose, and it isn't to ensure that you've got 5 A stars or 5 A stars to see, at least at GCSE and so on, to take you into the world of work. So people like John Dewey and Bertrand Russell, believing that education has a value in itself, that actually what it is for is to help design better human beings. And Chomsky, who you've considered this week, is it about creating human capital for economic growth or to develop free creative individuals? Indoctrination versus enlightenment. Idea that came through the video clip that you watched this week. The current education system is geared to pass hurdles rather than to learn, understand and explore. It matters what you discover rather than what you actually cover. I think I'm fresh in my mind of conversations in school about the curriculum. Have echoes with you, Jason, about we need to make sure we cover, that's the verb that we would use, that we cover this aspect of the national curriculum. Have we covered this by doing some thinking this way? So that idea of coverage rather than that discovering. Okay. And some people would argue if you put a national curriculum at the centre of what we do in schools, and a curriculum that is knowledge-based, then what you're doing is covering essentials, the best that is supposed to be passed on, whatever that may look like, rather than perhaps that whole idea of creativity and discovery in learning. Johnny, I like questions.
Just
there. Jason with the microphone will approach you now, Johnny. Which calls into question Maslow's hierarchy of needs anyway, whether you actually need to do one and then the next one and the next one successfully.
It's a really, really important point.
Okay. What are those needs?
And how do we actually develop that?
Yeah, great point. Please do,
at any point, ask questions. Don't feel as though you've got to wait till the end.
That's great. Thank you, Johnny. A little bit more on Dewey. Okay. 1938 experience in education. One of those texts that it doesn't have to be less than 10 years old. Okay. Absolute key text for considering what education is all about. Okay. And it's picking up really on Michael Gove, isn't it? Since the subject, talking about acquisition of knowledge and skills, since the subject matter as well as standards of proper conduct are handed down from the past, the attitude of pupils must, upon the whole,
be one of docility, receptivity and obedience. The idea of education is about passing on a perceived best knowledge to future generations. So that puts parameters around children's learning, and therefore it makes them conform into a system. Okay, so that we have generations of people who do conform to a system, and they don't think, and they don't challenge, and they don't ask questions. And that is something very much that that Julie was challenging in 1938. And here we are, still discussing it in 2016. It's interesting to look at the purposes of education from a historical point of view. If I was writing this assignment, the second time I've said that, but if I was, I would have to be really careful that I didn't spend 5,000 words writing about the history of education, because it's actually quite easy to get drawn into that. But if you do go backwards hundreds of years, then thinking about Plato and Socrates and the whole purpose of learning and education there, and how education evolved, so and in whose power, who had the control. You might say that, we might say that the government is very much in control of the curriculum and of education in 2016. Hasn't always been the case. And thinking about the role of universities as they began to evolve. Somebody in my group this morning passed a very interesting comment that really education is all about getting to university. Flip that on its head. Do the demands of universities actually control what we teach in school? Okay, is that the ultimate goal? And very much for a wealthy male elite, for positions of power in the government. It was also in the hands of the church, and the whole idea of education was to prepare young men for their role in a religious life. And then that changed over time. This is the world's shortest potted history of the history of education. Moving on to the Industrial Revolution, and then with industrialists realising that what actually we need is a workforce for our new factories and to generate wealth for the country. And then there was this minimum curriculum put together to educate children and young people so they could actually work in factories and produce the wealth for the nation and for the industrialists who owned the industries as well. And then as in the last 200 years, the whole idea that actually education needs to move beyond for the working class in factories, for the wealthy elite, that it actually should become a right of every single child and young person in our country, that they should have access to free education. Okay, so that whole social dimension, that for social equality. Okay, and you can read around that and you can look at, and it's really, I find it really interesting, look at how that's evolved over the, say, several hundreds of years. Okay, I said 25 minutes ago that from my perspective, in order to decide who should define the curriculum, you need to think about, well, what's it for, what's its purpose? And what I've chosen to focus on is the whole aspect of social justice. Because going along with my lens from slide one, okay, about equality of access to the absolute best in learning and teaching that we can give to children, for me, for my personal philosophy, what underpins that is the whole idea of social justice. There are other things that come into it, in terms of basic skills, but this is the area I've decided to focus on. It's what I believe to be the purpose, the main purpose of education. Okay. I am deliberately moving out of camera shot here in order that everybody can just see those statistics. to say about those statistics, you know, be aware of some of them already. Surprised? Shocked? Question. Anybody want to throw any light on that? How do you actually calculate that cost for the literacy? Any ideas? It's working on the basis that if you have communities and countries that don't have those standards of literacy, that as children grow older, the chances of them being involved in crime, in being in situations of social disadvantage, then that costs society and those communities money. And that's how it's calculated. So it's they calculate the impact and the cost of that impact in terms of lawlessness, crime, and so on. And that's how the cost is calculated. I just think it's interesting that those trillions of dollars, if you put that side by side with the whole idea of education actually growing economies and a way of economies earning money, and yet literacy still costs us that. 2012, 4 years ago, but it'll be interesting when the next set of data comes out to look at what the impact has had for 4 years and whether those statistics have changed. Okay. Because for me, and the reason I put that slide up there, because for me, education and particularly language, spoken language, reading, writing, to me, we're going to write an equation that equals power. That equals the power for people to take themselves out of poverty and out of risk and out of vulnerable situations. And that, for me, underpins what the purpose of education is about. Okay. Just conscious I'm maybe standing in the way. Malala, just wave, do a wave. You picked up on camera, it'd be quite nice, actually. Wave to me if you've heard of Malala. Young girl, I'll just stand out of shot for a minute. Just as you read that, just remind yourselves of who she is. Since 2012, continued her campaign for education for girls. I think that's an amazing quote. If the new generation isn't given parents, they will be given guns by the terrorists. The idea that education. And we touched on this in my room this morning. We were talking about the prevent strategy and what you talk to children about and how much you explain to them about what is actually going on in the world in terms of terrorism. And when do you do that in primary schools? Do you do that? Do you do that when they're 4 years old and they're talking about what they see on the news? But the idea that education is a way of preventing terrorism such that Malala herself was a victim of. You'll be aware that she was 16. On her 16th birthday, she spoke to UN delegates to demand free education for all, and the YouTube clip is there for you to remind yourselves of that if you haven't already seen it. She was nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize in 2013. Why didn't she get it? Any idea?
Too young.
Too young, absolutely. I was judged to be too young. Not on the basis of that what she'd done, you know, wasn't quite enough, but she was actually too young. So, but in 2014, she was a joint winner and the youngest ever recipient of the Nobel Peace Prize. Okay, and that's the link to two texts that you may be well aware of. There's a young reader's version of her story that is brilliant for using in school. Okay, so we've gone through possible purposes of education, what I perceive to be the purpose of education, and you're sitting there thinking, okay, then Kath gets the point, who should define the curriculum? Okay. This is very much my view. Okay. I think the curriculum should be in the hands of teachers, educationists, working with local authorities, if we have any left, I have to add that on, and cooperative trusts, children's agencies and providers, people who are directly involved in working with children, by taking the curriculum out of the hands of politicians. Okay, that's my viewpoint, and I'll put that a little bit further in a minute. Why? Because I perceive education to be very much in the hands of the government and in the control of the government. What it means is that potentially every 5 years, when there's a change of government and a change of political party, is that we have a succession of initiatives and changes and developments when, as a profession, we haven't had time to actually put through the last lot and evaluate those to see what impact they're having on children's learning before the next lot of initiatives come along. There's a bit of a cliche to talk about education being a political football. And let's use it, that's passed from one side to the other. Okay. So that there's always change. And why does that change happen? Is it really for the benefit of our children, or is it for political expediency? So taking it out of the hands of politicians. Okay. Russell Hobby, General Secretary of the National Association of Head Teachers, talking in March this year. Now, looking with your critically evaluative lenses, yours, you can say he's a teacher, he's working as part of a union, a professional association, then be evaluative that he's speaking very, very much on behalf of teachers. Our task as a profession is to crowd out the political narrative of failure with a professional narrative of ambition. Okay? Are we in a point in education where the perception, and particularly through the media, is that education in our schools is not good enough. It's failing. That's the view of the media. Is that the view of the government? Is that the view of Ofsted? This idea that it isn't good enough. But do we as teachers, as a profession, need to turn that around and say, actually, no. It isn't like that at all, and this is what we're doing, and we need to take that control. So, okay, it's time. People who are most ambitious for the children of this country are the people who have dedicated their careers to working with them. And I think that a not too subtle point being made there, that teachers who have been teachers for 12 months, 2 years, 22 years, 32 years, dedicating their lives to children and making a difference for those children, they're the ones who ought to be defining actually what it is that children learn. How on earth do you do that? One possible way that I would suggest to you this afternoon is to think about the notion of a college of teaching. Let's have another camera wave. Who's heard of the College of Teaching? Just Jason then, okay? In a way, I'm going to say good, because thinking, okay, this is perhaps something different for you to consider. Over the last 10 years, probably, there has been a move towards establishing an organisation that, a professional organisation that represents teachers. Not a union, not a professional association, but a professional body, in the same way as doctors and surgeons have the Royal College of Medicine, Royal College of Surgeons, there's the British Medical Association, there are law societies, there are professional bodies that those professionals belong to, and they work together to share research and good practice, and that informs their decisions about how their particular profession should develop in the future. Okay. So, simple analogy. If you're a surgeon, when my brother had his hip replacement surgery a couple of years ago, the perceived then best way of doing it, or the best kind of hip he needed, whether it was going to be titanium or whatever it was going to be, was decided by the surgeons and a group of surgeons and all of the research, all of the medical research that has been carried out to inform their decision. The Secretary of State for Health was not there saying, well, actually, I think that what Ian needs is this kind of... There is nowhere near, I'm not saying the NHS isn't political, because there is obviously a huge amount of political intervention, but the ultimate decisions about the best way of doing things, if you are in the world of medicine, is by you as practitioners and through research. But in education, we have that very strong government intervention. Okay, so this College of Teaching then is to which teachers would join, pay a fee, as you do if you're a surgeon or you're a lawyer or so on, that takes responsibility for its own development. Okay. In 2014, it was announced, new Education Secretary, Nicky Morgan, this was still under the coalition government, because you've got David Laws there, who's a Liberal Democrat, that the government support this College of Teaching. Could this be the vehicle for teachers and those in the world of education actually deciding what the curriculum should be? News item, a creation of a new professional body led and owned by teachers themselves without interference from the government. No, 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 it's just backtrack. So the government announces that it's going to support this body, and then it's going to be without interference from the government to help bolster that professional status and ultimately improve learning for children. Okay. Over time, greater responsibilities for areas such as professional standards, continuous professional development, moving stewardship of the profession out of the hands of the government and to the profession. I think it would be brilliant, wouldn't it? Okay. Russell Hobby again endorsing this idea. Okay, will it build consensus, get representative bodies to take this project forward? Interestingly, what I've been unable to find, and you might if you start looking at this, is any reference to actually defining the curriculum. Yes, your own professional development is there, but nothing quite a step yet about defining the curriculum. Maybe that will come. Okay. And then, 12 months ago, the government Holland said that it's going to financially back this independent college of teaching. That's great, isn't it? They gave it their verbal support, now they're saying we're going to financially back this as well. Okay. Putting the profession on a par with other high status careers such as law and medicine. Okay. Similar to the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons. Completely independent of government and led by teachers. Okay. And making a payment. That sounds quite good, doesn't it? Does anything strike you about that though? If you put on your critically evaluative hat, or your cynical hat, depending on how you want to look at it, anything strike you about that? Where was that? I think really, yeah, the voice is back there. Okay, the idea about having to pay a fee. So some teachers, some voices against this are saying that it's made it, that would make it an elitist body, particularly if you're thinking about £130 a year. Who's going to pay that? I don't know what the fees are to join the Royal College of Surgeons. Anybody know? Do anybody happen to have that snippet of information in their mind? Be good, wouldn't it? But how that would compare? But some people are saying that you should be free. What should qualify you to join is the fact that you are a teacher, a professional in the world of education. Okay, Katie, where are you? Jason, Katie's just yeah. I do wonder how this will work, that if you've got a body that is perceived to be free from government intervention, but they are backing it with money, I don't honestly know whether that's going to work and whether it will actually remain independent of the government or not. But be an interesting one to watch. Okay. Claim Your College, website there, is the consortium that has the responsibility for developing this college of teaching. So maybe worth a look at if you're interested. But if you go on their website, that's their first paragraph. Will be independent, free from political influence. Okay. Last year, I came across Dr. Deborah Kidd, whose book is entitled Teaching, Notes from the Front Line, okay, which evokes battlefields and armies and fighting, isn't it? And deliberately entitled that. Deborah Kidd is a teacher and a writer, member of the Royal Society of Arts. I really do commend this book to you. It's a really, really interesting read. Okay, I'm just going to let you read that rather than reading it to you. As a profession, we beg to be outstanding, said. We crave affirmation that what we are doing well.
Kath, sorry, could you say
who it was
by again?
Sorry?
Could you say
who it was by again? Yeah, she's called, so it's Kid, it's Deborah, D-E-B-R-A. It's on the list of references at the end of this PowerPoint that I will put up on Google. But Kid, K-I-D-D. And it's called Teaching, Notes from the Front Line. It's a real, it's quite a vitriolic attack, which is quite pleasing at times to read. We take this relentless critical interference from people who rarely understand the complexities of classroom interactions or the difficulties of balancing all the competing needs of children, paperwork and parental expectations. Okay. Now, it's all in the hands of people who don't actually understand what it's like to be a teacher. Okay. And that just finishes off with my references there. I'll just backtrack on that for a moment. So, what I have endeavoured to do then is to take you through what I perceive to be the main purpose of education, my own values, my own vision. And said, okay, well, if that is the purpose of education, then who should actually be looking at that? Who knows how best to work with children? And in, from my point of view, it's teachers and educationists. It doesn't, some of you may want to challenge me on that, it doesn't mean that I will never talk to parents, that I will never talk to children about their role, but the actual control of this perceived body of knowledge, what is it the children need to know, should be much more firmly in the hands of teachers and not in the hands of the government. It's my point of view. Time for a few questions, should you wish to ask me any. I'm poised and waiting. Disagree with me, I will not take it personally. Now seriously, these are all designed to get you thinking, and Jason promised me earlier that he would either heckle or he would make my life difficult. Mr. Holland, anything you wish to ask me?
No one else has asked
the
question.
Is
it my turn to work
or not? Do you need to press it again? Is the light on that nobody's?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I mean,
there's lots of things that I think are probably repeating in a few minutes' time. But in terms of education professionals taking control of the curriculum, do you feel that actually that kind of narrows it? It's quite a narrow group of people in some respects. You know, people have chosen education as their profession. Quite possibly have only known that to come from school into a higher education, back into an education setting. So they decide on what that curriculum might look like.
I take your point. It could be perceived as narrow, but I would perceive that that body of professionals, whatever the vehicle is, that they would be talking to other people, that they would be talking to children and to parents and to other professions. They would gain those other views and those different perspectives, but at the heart, they would have that responsibility. What I want, my vision, is I want a shared understanding by everybody, not just by the government and the DfE, of what those core values are in terms of education. What is it that we're actually trying to do? And I think that the best vehicle for doing that is via teachers seeking other views, rather than in the hands of transient politicians.
When you said it should be free from political influence. What's your thoughts on people voting for the political influence they want in power? Why should that not change the education system on a regular basis, responding to the needs of society at that time?
That's a really good question. That's a really good question. I'm going to try and paraphrase that. So, thinking about an education system that is free from political influence. What's wrong with the, really, you're talking about the democratic process, aren't you? Of people saying, this is the manifesto and the promises about education that I want to vote for. What's wrong with that? There isn't anything wrong with that in terms of democracy, but I feel that the democracy needs to come out of a system where we are voting for a change in government or not, and is actually already decided democratically by all kinds of representatives led by teachers, so that we don't have, you can vote for a Conservative manifesto and their promises on education, you can vote for a Labour one, but why is it like that? Wouldn't it be better? better and better for children to learning and their futures if we already had that perceived way of doing things, and this is the curriculum and this is the knowledge, rather than a group of people who are politically, with a large P, swayed by one ideological vision, if you like, than another one. That's a really good question, thank you.
Sorry, I'm going to build on that as well. Because it'd be said that everyone has an ideological perspective, and actually, when trying to find the people's opinion, you may load questions to fit your own ideological perspective already.
Mm-hmm.
That's the problem the government have with their reports and things. When they go out and write reports on what
yeah.
the current state of the education system is,
yeah.
aren't they doing, aren't they already trying to show that they're asking teachers and asking professionals about what they think? I know.
By consulting
yeah.
other people.
You can consult others, but the
mm.
person in power may still decide to do something different regardless.
Yeah. So the question is about whether the government are actually doing that now. They are consulting, they are seeking other views. And that is quite, it's a huge process to go through. But I do think the whole government DfE consultation process is quite an interesting one. We can all ask, can't we? We can all ask people what they think about things, and yes, we put it out to consultation and then not do anything about it. But it depends on what you have set up in the first place that you want people to consult on. So, and you're right, it depends who's writing the document. Who writes the draft national curriculum that is put out to consultation? You know, it's not a blank sheet of paper, give us your ideas on the curriculum. It's, this is what we think the curriculum should look like, what do you think? Do you want to be presenting that narrow viewpoint? Yeah. It's a hard one. Don't necessarily think I've answered your question, but it was a really interesting one. Okay, I'm going to pause there. Thank you for listening, thank you for your questions, particularly, we had some really interesting questions there. We'll take a pause while we swap places, okay, Jason and I, and we get to the next stage of the presentation, Benji. Yeah? Okay. And I'll stop wandering around.
Thank you. returns, look at your book, have a chat to someone next year, and then sit down again. So not fidgeting for the hour. Do you want to do that? Just stand up. Have a bit of a move around. Come on. It's important to define that and get that straight, I think, before we talk about who really should. So I guess I'm making a sort of apology for doing that in the first instance. Before we do that, a quick history lesson though, because we've been here before in terms of the new curriculum. The old curriculum, of course, going back to 1988. But in 2009, we had the Rose Review. Now, the Rose Review was brought about by a different government. It was brought about because they felt the 1988 curriculum was too prescribed, very overloaded with content. Ed Balls asked Jim Rose to produce a far less prescriptive curriculum, give teachers more flexibility. They like to talk about that. Within the 1988 curriculum, there's no time to teach in depth. And there's little consolidation of learning because there was so much, there's so much content. They wanted greater flexibility to meet the pupils' needs. And so they all reorganised the curriculum completely. 6 broad areas of learning. Essential subject content was vital, they said. But actually they needed more. There was a big emphasis on spoken communication, realising that youngsters and children as they move through secondary education weren't so adept at communicating verbally, and certainly when they went out into the working world, they lacked that skill, so there's a lot of emphasis on that. Big emphasis on cross-curricular learning as well. And a lot more about performing and visual arts, especially role play and drama. So the curriculum was completely redesigned in 2009. And I remember being ahead at the time and being really enthused by this, and actually it was very warmly received by a lot of teachers and a big proportion of the profession. It never came to pass. It never came to pass because we had an election. We had a change of government and out it went. And there was an incredible investment there in terms of time and money. I certainly remember going along to organised talks where they introduced the curriculum. In fact, I went to one with Jim Rose himself where he was talking about the process of developing the new curriculum and how we should introduce it in schools. So yeah, as I say, it never came to pass. An excerpt from the news at the time. Schools in a curriculum vacuum. Now, I know you're all education, you can read perfectly, but I will read it out. Pointless. So the planned reform of the primary curriculum in England based on last year's review led by Sir Jim Rose has been scrapped. Primary schools are still completely stunned by this. Teachers have been working hard, absorbing Rose's review, and we really have been working hard, believe me, into their planning, and we're gearing up to deliver it. Then, at a stroke, all those months of preparation were rendered pointless. So for now, schools have been told to carry on teaching the current primary national curriculum until at least July 2012. Remember that the Rose review was the first fundamental review of the primary curriculum for more than a decade. It has spent over a year gathering evidence. Then, because it was associated with the previous government, it was simply discarded. So that was BBC News, 19th of June 2010. And that's absolutely true. I mean, we spent an awful lot of time, effort, introducing that new curriculum in 2009, 2010, for it to just disappear overnight. So, since the 1988 National Curriculum, going back again, we've had this. So at that time, 1988 National Curriculum, there was the Department of Education Science. That ran from 64 to 92. And then in 1992, it changed and became the Department for Education, which was in existence there for, 3 years, then became the Department for Education and Employment for another 6 years, then it changed again from the Department for Education Skills for 6 years, and then it became the Department for Children, Schools and Families for another 3 years, and now we're back to the DfE again. For how long, who knows? But you see my point in terms of there's a lot of change, a lot of governmental change, and how that might impact on how we operate in education. And that doesn't even take into account changes in political party. Secretary of State for Education, or Secretary for the State of Education, as we might like to call it. But our audience participation time now. Who's that person? Nicky Morgan. And her background before coming into politics, she was a corporate lawyer. I hope I've got my facts straight on this. This one. You can find so many bad pictures of him, isn't it? Before he came into politics, he was a news reporter, a writer, and an editor. This one. Ed Balls. So he was also a news reporter, particularly an economic writer. And he became an economic advisor. And then this one. It's getting harder now, isn't it? Alan Johnson. He was a Tesco shelf stacker. Not that I've got anything else against Tesco shelf stackers. Try to say that quickly. Also a postman, he left school at the age of 15. That's where he was before he went into party politics. But he went straight from that into party politics. This one? Anyone? With Kath. And she was as well, she was a news reporter as well, economic writer. This one? Charles Clark. Yeah, and he was into economics as well, but particularly public affairs management. And then this rather somber looking lady. Come on then.
Estelle Morris.
Absolutely! Estelle Morris. She was Secretary of Education 2001 to 2002. And there, lo and behold, we have someone who's got some background in education. Who's actually in charge of, as it were, education. I'll make that point, and I think the point I'm trying to make is fairly obvious. The fact that actually people who are making some really key, significant decisions about how education appears in this country have actually no background, potentially no interest in education themselves. So, currently, 2014 onwards, we now have a rewritten curriculum. The government appointed their panel of experts. Their brief was to emulate, as Kath mentioned before, one of the world's most successful school systems based on international test scores. And I'll come on to international test scores in a bit. But yes, so Hong Kong, Singapore, State of Alberta, and the State of Massachusetts were four key ones that they were told to look at. The government said the new national curriculum would provide rigour and a stronger grasp of information and facts. Stuff. You needed to know stuff. Things. Teachers unions attacked it. It's a bit of a pub quiz curriculum. You know, it's about what you knew. GCSE and A levels were redesigned, less coursework and modules, back to exams. In fact, I was talking to secondary colleagues the other day, and I think they're saying now with GCSEs, just a student taking just the standard sort of GCSEs when they go to leave school, they'll be taking at least 30 hours worth of exams. And actually their focus at the moment is student mental health and being able to sit those and be able to sort of perform in those without crumbling, essentially. And the new GCSE gradings numbers 9 to 9. So we've got this new fancy curriculum. So, as Kath has done, let's talk politics. Party politics are generally always divided on how school should be run and what should be taught. There's a lot of political firefighting and shaping policy around electoral cycles. As I said, that previous curriculum by Jim Rhodes, a year researching and beginning to introduce that, completely scrapped overnight with a new political party. You know, it's a ridiculous situation in my mind. The school curriculum is to be based on ministerial whims, as Castle was suggested earlier on. A lot of the curriculum people felt was influenced by Michael Gove's schooling and what he wanted to see in the curriculum according to his ideals. So politicians should devolve decision making about education to a non-political organisation. That's my view. This broad representative group would define curriculum content. So, in a nutshell, it's not quite the end of my talk there. Who should buy the curriculum? Certainly who shouldn't? Politicians and political parties. So who should? An independent, politically neutral body. I'll explain a bit more about that in a bit. An independent body. So, very simply, and top of my list, teachers, very much like Kath, I think those people who actually are involved day-to-day in education should be the people who define what the curriculum looks like. But they would need help. It's got to be a broader view than that. Employers. We often hear about what employers want and what employers feel are missing in those children coming through education and those young people who leave school. And so they would need to have some sort of say and involvement in what that curriculum would look like. Some say and involve that. Academics. It's about research and knowing what works well in education. Certainly political parties have been damned because a lot of what they want to do is based on cherry picking, certain things that have worked in different countries, and a lot of so-called research, but many question actually what the basis of that research, how broad was that research, how well validated is it. So academics need to be at that table. And I'm trying to be realistic here, there would need to be political party representatives. So I don't think we can discount the entire, because we have got a democratic system, and we do vote for these people, and so they would need some sort of place at that table. By having an independent body that was free of political parties and political cycles, you'd get that consistency and a strategic view, so we're not dependent on an electoral cycle. The political football saying here, I've used that. Education has been a political football for too long, and this way we would avoid that happening. So we were taking party and personality politics, and the confrontation that you get in politics, and the way that it's used as a football in politics, we would take that out of education. So out with politics. So education policy would be about collaboration, devoid of political interference. There'd be a balanced perspective from a representative group of people. I'll come on to who that representative group of people would be. I mean, I've talked about teachers, academics, employers, and I feel that we need to be a larger representation, but I'll come on to that. Contributions and participation of the whole team involved in delivering education. An absolute no to personal visions of education based on personal experience. This harking back to when I was at school and what worked well for me then. Education, the world has changed dramatically in the last 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, and it will change dramatically, I think more dramatically over the next decade or decades. And so we need to be responsive to that and not harking back on to personal experiences and what we felt when we were at school. and certainly no scoring political points by denouncing different views. A lot of the reason why Jim Rose's went out, of course, was actually that was the view of the other party, and so we can't be seen to be agreeing with that. Political involvement, not political interference. And so what do we want? So trying to encapsulate what we would want out of a curriculum in a nutshell. So for an education system to empower pupils and benefit individuals and society, as well as business and the economy, and I'll come on to that in a minute, because again, as Kath sort of hinted at, a lot of what we do is driven by an economic argument. And again, that's important, but shouldn't be a driving force. It must enable qualified professional teachers to contribute to curriculum design and delivery, so that pupils gain not only knowledge and skills, but the ability to apply them to all aspects of their lives, to very broad curriculum. No one listening to me for a moment. I want to play a YouTube clip. It may well be what you've seen before, but even if you have, it's always refreshing to see it again, I think. It's by a spoken word artist, and even if you're not into that genre of music, I think the message that comes across is really important. And I hope the technology works here. Have we got volume?
Came down and dropped the live session, and a lot of you were excited about that. I was excited this morning when I opened up a package, had no idea what it was. Opened it up, put it in the player, press play, and it totally blew me away. It's this brand new piece from his brand new The Dorm Room EP. I'm gonna have to let spoken word do what it does best and let it speak for itself. Brand new Sully Breaks.
She'll say something along the lines of, you know, to get a good job, you need a good degree. And these subjects will help you get a good degree. We never had this opportunity when I was younger. And he will reply, but you were younger a long time ago, weren't you? And she won't respond, although what he implies makes perfect sense, that society's needs would have changed since she was 16. But she will ignore him, grip his hand more sternly, then drag him to the car. But what she doesn't know is that she didn't ignore him just to shut him up. She didn't lie because they were just returning from parents' evening and an argument in the hallway would look bad on her resume. She won't lie because she just spent the last 1 hour convincing a stern-faced teacher that she would ensure that her child's studies were at home. No, she would lie simply because she does not know any better herself. Although her whole adult life, she has never used or applied Pythagoras' theorem to perfect fallacy and still does not know the value of X, she will rely on society to tell her that her child, who has one of the sharpest minds in the school, is hyperactive, unfocused, easily distracted, and wayward. Students, how many equations, subjects, and dates did you memorize just before an exam never to use again? How many A grades did you get, which were never asked for when you applied for a job? How many times have you remembered something 5 minutes just after the teacher said stop writing, only to receive your results 1 month later to realize that you were only 1 mark short of the top grade? Does that mean remembering 5 minutes earlier would have made you more qualified for a particular job? Well, on application form, it would have. We all have different abilities, thought processes, experiences, and genes. So why is a class full of individuals tested by the same means? So does that mean Cheryl thinks she's dumb because she couldn't do a couple of sums? And if this issue is not addressed properly, it then becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Then every school has the audacity to have a policy on equality. The irony. Exams are society's methods of telling you what you're worth. But you can't let society tell you what you are, because it's the same society that tells you that abortion but then looks down on teenage parents. The same society that sells products to promote natural hair, looks and smooth complexion, with the model on the box half photoshopped and has fake lashes and hair extensions, with pastors that preach charity but own private jets, imams that preach against greed but all fat, parents that say they want educated kids but constantly marvel at how rich Richard Branson is, governments that preach peace but endorse wars, that say they believe so much in the importance of higher education and further learning, then why increase tuition fees every single year? I believe Miss Jefferson when she took me into the office and said that my exams would be imperative to my success, because we was taught to always follow when Miss Jefferson led. But then I took Jefferson out of the equation and learned to think for myself. I realised we was taught to always follow when Miss led. Huh, the irony. Test us with tests, but the finals are never final, because they never prepare us for the biggest test, which is survival. And what I suggest is fairly outlandish, so I do not expect everyone to understand this, except for the kids who knows what it feels like to be worth no more than that D or that A that you get on results day. And the ones whose best stories were never good enough for the English teacher, because apparently you missed out key literal techniques, did not follow the class plan, and the language was too informal for him to understand. But then he referenced Hamlet and Macbeth, and you fight the urge to express your contempt by partially clenching your fist with only your medius finger left protruding in the middle of your hand, and then asked if he was aware that Shakespeare was known as the innovator of slang, or the kid at the back of the class who thinks, why am I studying something that doesn't fuel my drive? But then when confronted with a maths problem, his eyes come alive. So this one is for my generation, the ones who found what they were looking for on Google, the ones who followed their dreams on Twitter, pictured their future on Instagram, accepted destiny on Facebook. This one's for my failures and my dropouts, for my unemployed graduates, my shop assistants, cleaners and cashiers with bigger dreams, my self-employed entrepreneurs, my world changers and my dream chasers, because the purpose of why I hate school but love education was not to initiate a worldwide debate, but to let them know that whether 72 or 88, 44 or 68, we will not let exam results decide our fate. Peace.
Rankings. Now these tests, of course, as Kath pointed out, are given to 50-year-olds in many, many different countries, and then we're ranked. Success stories such as Finland, international bywords now for educational excellence, and politicians start to cherry-pick parts of those things that they want to see in their education systems into ours. Things that PISA data is for. It's based on unsound statistical techniques. Accurately ranking diverse education systems is madness. I mean, education systems across the world are all very, very different. And just ranking them, making comparisons, and then cherry picking certain bits out of some of them to apply to other ones is really just not sound thinking whatsoever, in my opinion. PISA comparisons often based on different students answering different questions. And switching these questions around can lead to huge variations in rankings as well. So UK can finish anywhere between 14th and 30th in one particular set of tests that I was looking at. We had PISA. So 50 plus different education systems are tested, and they operate in a variety of different cultures. PISA tests are culturally and linguistically biased towards certain countries, something again which is often talked about when they talk about PISA outcomes. They wield enormous influence, but their necessary simplicity renders them imperfect for making these comparisons. It's a lack of awareness about these limitations. I mean, certainly when expanded across the media, there's very little talk about this. People just accept these P pizza rankings as the be-all and end-all of what is successful in education, really without asking any questions about why and how, what makes them this perfect judge about how we educate young people. There's quite a bit of large emphasis on a narrow range of measurable aspects of education. And that's what we come back to all the time, not just in PISA rankings, but in tests throughout education. It's about what can be measured. Takes attention away from less measurable and some immeasurable educational objectives, physical, moral, civic, and artistic development. All those things which are in eye value, and I think many people in education value highly, but actually it's very difficult to measure, or actually impossible to measure in some instances. And because of course you can't measure it, you can't compare it, and so politicians can't use it as part of the weaponry in terms of arguing what's best and what's not, and so it gets ignored. So we therefore have a dangerously narrowing our collective imagination regarding what education is and ought to be because of these narrow tests and the significant emphasis that is placed on the outcomes from them. Now, PISA, of course, is run by OECD, the Organisation for Economic Cooperation and Development. There's a significant and a serious economic slant to all that these people do. An organisation of economic development, naturally biased in favour of the economic role of schools. What they do for young people and society from an economic perspective. That's what they see as success in education. And I would argue, personally, that that is not our primary goal. Preparing children for gainful employment is one thing that we do in education, but it's not the only thing, and certainly I'd argue it shouldn't be the main thing, the main goal of education. I would suggest PISA global testing regime harms children, it impoverishes our classroom. We've got more and longer multiple choice testing, more scripted lessons, less autonomy of teachers, all those things that in the Rose Review they were trying to bring back, that flexibility for teachers, gone. Very much teaching to the tests. And we're seeing that more and more now, particularly in our education system with the SATs and the emphasis that's put on SATs in year 2 and year 6, and the impact that has on what children are receiving in their education is profound. And not good at all. PISA, in my opinion, has further increased already high stress levels in schools, which endangers the well-being of pupils and teachers. So you get the idea that really I'm not impressed with PISA and how they operate. And the fact that they're used so belligerently by political parties to make their points and to justify changes to curriculum content. So reforms should be based on a single narrow measure of quality. And PISA tests are a single narrow measure of quality. We cannot ignore socioeconomic inequalities, cultural expectations, historical factors, prejudices, religious ideologies, etc. These tests are taken in 50 plus countries across the globe. We can't make those comparisons in such diverse cultures. Comparing developing countries where 15-year-olds are regularly drafted into child labour, in the first world countries makes neither educational nor political sense. And this quote by Albert Einstein, not everything that counts can be counted, and not everything that can be counted actually counts. So trying to base our curriculum content and the direction of our education based on tests, particularly PISA tests, is an absolute nonsense and something which should no longer happen at all. So, where have we got to? Who should define the curriculum? What should they base it on? So who shouldn't? I think we've established, or I'd like to think of established, politicians and political parties absolutely should have no say in this whatsoever, apart from perhaps some involvement around the table. Who should? An independent, politically neutral body. What shouldn't it be based on? International test outcomes. What should be based on, in my opinion, validated research in education. So, rant over. Independent body. So, it'd be made up from a group of relevant people. And this is where it gets a little bit tricky because it's about trying to include all the right people, isn't it? So currently, the groups who have greatest influence on what and how international learning is assessed are psychometricians, statisticians, and economists. And Yes, they deserve a seat at the table, I guess I would argue. But in my opinion, we need to include lots of other people. Parents, educators particularly, administrators, community leaders, children, anthropologists, sociologists, historians, philosophers, linguists, artists, and humanitarians. That's quite a long list. And all of a sudden, you start to come across problems, I think, because you've got a very large group of people who you all feel perhaps have a right to be sat at that table, offering their thoughts, offering their ideas on what a curriculum should look like. The curriculum should be subject to discussions involving all these groups, I think, at local, national, and international levels. It should go beyond the economic aspect of education. The economic aspect of education is very much what drives our school set up and how our curriculum is defined, and that really does need to stop. A focus on health, human development, well-being, and for me, most importantly, perhaps happiness. In my mind, a successful education system and a successful curriculum will be about those elements, particularly happiness. Surely the fundamental goal of education is about human happiness. People might argue that economics and economic wealth brings that about. We would explore more meaningful and less easily sensationalised ways of reporting educational outcomes as well. This is what happens a lot with party politics. Things are sensationalised. Certain statistics are used to define certain things and to propound certain arguments and prove certain theories. And other things are completely ignored, as politics choose to do. And so it's about not sensationalising outcomes from tests, comparisons like that. What would the curriculum look like? I'm coming to this from a different angle, I guess, from Kath, in terms of building up the other way, I suppose. It should be a cultural construct, a preparation for global citizenship, whatever that means, derived from what we value most highly for our children. And again, that would involve the conversation between all those groups of people. What a society deems to be worthwhile, knowledge, skills, and understanding would be important. There are certain elements of knowledge that we would need. Skills and understanding, skills particularly, and I would argue skills are the most important thing, because knowledge is finite, and knowledge changes over time. And so the skill, the ability to take on knowledge, assimilate it, process it, and come to our own opinions on it, is very, very important. Instilling a love of learning for its own sake would be crucial within any curriculum. To develop good attitudes to learning and a disposition to learn. So children and young people want to learn. It's an enjoyable experience rather than as a way of passing set-defined tests at certain stages in schooling. It will need to be dynamic and not static. So 1988 was when our sort of first modern curriculum came out. It was going to be reviewed, but of course the most recent one is 2014. That's a big old gap between two points in time. And who knows when it will be defined or redefined again. Our world is ever changing dramatically, and has changed dramatically over a period of time, certainly in the last few decades, and will change dramatically, as I said earlier, again in the next few decades. So a static curriculum is just not a good place to be. Any change in curriculum would need to be carefully managed, but it needs to be dynamic. It needs to be aimed at fulfilled lives and for contributing to the common good of civilised, democratic society. A unifying set of values and aims for the whole of education rather than disparate and different values and aims for each of the three parts. We've got very distinct parts at the moment in terms of early years, which is taught in a very different way from primary school, Q-stage 1, Q-stage 2, and again, very different from really how secondary is going to be. Going back a couple of steps, Every Child Matters, 2003. I like this because it was very simple in many senses. It said, what do we want for our children? We want them to be healthy. We want them to stay safe. We want them to enjoy and achieve, to make a positive contribution to society, and to achieve economic well-being. So economic well-being comes into it. But actually, that came bottom line. I like this. I'm not advocating this as a way forward, but in 2023, the HR Matters agenda came out, and it was good. It defined the kind of outcomes that we would want for children. Key attributes of any curriculum. I was trying to think of what a curriculum would need to look like, what this group of people would come up with, and it is a challenge. And I just kind of tried to think of words that I would feel would describe a successful curriculum. So we need children to enjoy learning. So they enjoy exploring, knowing and understanding, making sense of things, fostering skills. We need to excite the imagination and enact dialogue. We want confident individuals. So we're looking at their well-being, their engagement, empowering them, autonomy, being independent. We're looking for responsible citizens, so respect and reciprocity within a society, interdependence and sustainability, local, national and global citizenship, culture and community, all those things that I think we need to consider in any worthwhile curriculum. The aim being to prepare young people for participation in democratic self-government, moral action and a life of personal development, growth and well-being. Most importantly, to enjoy learning. Enjoy learning for the sake of learning. Another clip that I want to show you, just to kind of round things off a little bit. Again, I'm almost certain you'll have seen this one, and there's been a number of iterations of this. I think this is the most recent one, but maybe not. It's a little bit Americanized, but you'll get the message, you'll get the drift of where I'm coming from with this, I think. Just to kind of highlight some of the things that I've been saying. It's a little bit long, I think it's about 5 minutes, but... Thank you. So our membership happened 2014, so it's already 2 years out of date. Many of those facts were changed quite considerably already. But I think that certainly raises lots of questions in terms of knowledge. How quickly our knowledge doubles, trebles, and we're talking about exponential numbers there. And the idea that knowledge is something that you can just decide what's best to know and then teach it to young people for them to know when they need it, when they leave school in X number of years' time. It raises lots of questions. And I've certainly not got all the answers. But what our curriculum would need to do is provide children and young people with the skills to be able to assimilate knowledge very quickly. Know where to find that knowledge, rather than retaining it here, have the skills to access that, to find it, to research it, and then to manipulate it. The idea of a job for life, very much gone. The idea of holding down various different jobs and redefining yourself and changing that skill set over short periods of time. There's lots of questions raised by that particular video. And sort of questions there that I'll leave with you, I guess. What I've talked about is about a curriculum that looks very different from the one we have at the moment. Defined by people, very different from the ones we find at the moment. I think I've raised more questions than I have answers, to be honest, because I've talked about the types of people who might be involved in that conversation and listed a lot of different types of people there, and then how that would actually practically work with all those people contributing to that and coming up with some kind of coherent curriculum would be a challenge. What I know it though is that the current way that we define the curriculum isn't the right way. It isn't successful. And what we would need to do is look to a different group of people, a non-political group of people, who could define that curriculum. And as I said earlier on, teachers particularly would be at the heart of that process, but with contributions, as Kath has said, from a variety of different people who would all have something to bring to the table. But it wouldn't be dictated by electoral cycles. And that really is what I have to say on that. I don't know if any of you have any questions on anything that I've brought in mind. I mean, I've got lots of questions.
I'll just speak really loudly.
Okay, that's what I did. Speak
really loudly. You said that you think employers should.
Yes.
How do you think that would look in a primary curriculum in comparison to a secondary? Because obviously secondary is a lot closer to when they're going into decision.
Yeah. Sure. I mean, it's primary sets up, I suppose, very basically speaking, for their secondary education. So really, I guess what we would be doing in a primary setting is preparing children for what the boys felt they needed when they left their secondary setting. So it's for teachers, hopefully within that you can decide the outcomes that employers would like to see, and trying to filter that down to think how can we establish certain basic core skills that primary level children would need in order to build on those skills for employers to see when they leave their secondary education. So very much that sort of preparation from primary to secondary. I'm kind of, in some ways, arguing against though what I was promoting earlier on, in fact, that primary-secondary phase shouldn't really be there. I mean, it's that all-through notion that we're teaching children, but what it would be a graded development of those skills that employers would want to see at the end of education, in my mind. So does that answer that question?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, just as you know, shift happens. That red situation, shift happens in this video. That talks about knowledge and how much it's changed over time, and how our knowledge back in sort of Shakespeare's time was this, and now it's this. And the idea that you can have a sort of finite set of knowledge and that will do you for your time in education and then beyond. In my mind, is a very limiting notion. And you know, when I'm looking to try to find things out, I'm not looking in here. I'm doing this. I'm looking on Google. I'm looking on the internet. I don't know something, that's what I do, that's what I, you know, that's what I imagine you all do. And teaching people the skills to be able to find out knowledge, in my mind, is far more important than them having that knowledge. There's certain basic knowledge that you need to be able to exist in what is a complex society. The ability to, I mean, for example, to know money, to be able to count, to be able to give across the right money and know the change you're expecting to receive. There's certain bits of knowledge that you will need, certain skills you will need. But beyond that, I think the skills to acquire more knowledge is far more important than knowledge itself. Is that an answer to your question?
How would you, who should take your independent body?
Yeah, very good question. I mean, at the moment, the government spend an awful lot of money on their experts and organising the curriculum and wasting money on tests that they then publish online. So perhaps channeling money in the correct way, in my mind, so redistribution essentially how they currently spend money on education would be a way to finance that independent body.
So it should still come from the government then?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we can't get away from the comment we said earlier on that we have a democratic society, a government, a political body that then sort of guides how we move. I think they can't absolve themselves of responsibility for education in that sense. But it's about funding it, but also then putting it into the hands of people who, the right people, who should then start to define that curriculum. Is that fair?
Yeah.
Fair enough, yeah. Any other questions?
I'm just sitting here out of view. You know, when you went through the slide about the current and then previous secretaries of state for education,
yeah.
You got down to Estelle Morris, 2001 to 2002, 12 months in post. Have you any observations on why, compared to others, she only lasted 12 months?
Yeah, I suppose to come back to my cynical view that actually she was trying to drive policies in a direction that actually supported what people in education would want to see. And actually in terms of that being supportive of the political direction and re-election and those kind of things, it wasn't in the best interests of the party. And so the person who perhaps was most able to add to that, discussion about how education should evolve and be delivered was actually the person who, in a political sense, was least able to then get that party re-elected. It's very much about that political cycle of election, re-election, or not. Any other questions?
Yes.
Has everyone seen that the Sunny Breaks spoken word artist? Have you seen that video before? A show of hands if anyone has. Okay, so some of you. Fascinating, wasn't it? And I think, I mean, that's a really salient message, I think, for me. It's about that testing regime that we have and what importance we place on that testing regime. And how remembering something 5 minutes later, does that make you more or less qualified to do a particular job when you leave school? Who knows? And then I imagine more people have seen the shift happen. Show of hands, who's seen the shift happen before? Okay, so okay, not definitely. So yeah, it sort of raises lots of questions, I think, but lots of salient questions about education at the moment, the priorities that we have, and potentially how a curriculum should be able to form to respond to a very, very quickly changing society and world that we live in. Thank you. Unless there's any other questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jason. Thank you for taking the time out of the thick of